Live from the North Carolina Museum of Natural Sciences in beautiful downtown Raleigh, it's the Science Café with your host, Brian Mallow.
Where is he? There we go. Hello. Welcome to Science Thursday. I think I feel like one of them is not muted. Did I not mute it? Thank you. So, welcome to Science Thursday. That's many false starts tonight, but it's okay. And I do feel like it's echoey, like we're hearing it through some of the TVs and we shouldn't be. So, I apologize for that. There we go. I think that helped. Tonight, we have a fantastic program, and we also have a special presentation right after it. So, we're going to be sure that we end the program right before 8 o'clock, and then we invite you to please join us in the Daily Planet, from the Daily Planet Cafe into the Daily Planet Theater, where we're going to show a short film, 18 minutes, that's completely, it's different but relevant to our program tonight. So the focus on our program here is on cephalopods, everyone's favorite creature of the sea, perhaps. They're smart, they have fantastic, mysterious abilities and camouflage, and they're just so alien to us. And it's also about the habitats along the East Coast where these creatures, where our guest studies these animals. And then our short film is called Pathways to the Abyss, and it's about the canyons themselves and the ecosystem where some of these and other creatures live. So it's a beautiful, and on the big screen in the Daily Planet, 18-minute film. So I know what we usually do when we adjourn the program, everyone kind of attach the speaker up here, but we're going to ask everyone, the speaker is going to join, we'll all go, you can attack her in the Daily Planet, but also enjoy this spectacular 18-minute film. So, with that said, welcome, I see a lot of familiar faces, is anyone here for the first time? Excellent, thank you for being here. We do this every Thursday, the first Thursday of each month we have Science Trivia Night, which has become fantastically popular, and you have to come early if you want to get a seat. But people compete, there are 30 science trivia questions, and it's a lot of fun. And the rest of our Thursdays, we have programs like this. It's a science cafe. It's not a formal lecture. It's casual. We have food and beverages, adult beverages, larval beverages. All the beverages are back there, available through the entire program. And restrooms are right around the corner. And so half the program is dependent on you because she'll give a 20 to 30 minute talk and it'll be followed by your questions. And you always do a fabulous job on that. The only thing I'll remind you is I'll be bringing the microphone around. We do record our programs. They stream live now, not only on livestream.com, but on YouTube. And then they're available there afterwards. But we want to get your mic, your questions recorded. So you get my attention and I'll bring the mic around to you. So, having said all that, are you ready for our program? As I already said, they're fantastic creatures. We all know them and love them. Maybe we don't know that much about them, and we're going to learn a little bit more about capturing them for research, really, is our emphasis tonight. So our guest comes from the Delaware Museum of Natural History, where she is the curator of mollusks, which is a broader category, including our cephalopods. How about a nice round of applause for Dr. Liz Shea?
Thank you so much. Well, it is really a treat to be here. I've had a lovely day having a tour of the exhibits. This is my first time here, first time in Raleigh, and it's just been absolutely tremendous resource that you folks have here, and it is really something to be treasured. And I know that folks from my museum have come down on occasion to have a look around and to get inspired by all of the wonderful educational programs and exhibits that go on here. So it has really been a great day. I've enjoyed myself tremendously, and I'm looking forward to talking a little bit about cephalopods in the Atlantic canyons. And so what I wanted to do was tell you a little bit about the animals themselves, but also because you're going to be talking about pathways to the canyons, here should be some of the canyons that I've been into within the Atlantic and the Northwest Atlantic, and we'll talk about some of the different ways in which we collect them, either using nets or using cameras or using videos. And also, this is my first time doing a talk like this. I usually give a talk, I turn around and go like this, so if I do that tonight, please forgive me. locations on the left hand and on the left side, we see it on the map, but we'll talk about the wavelength as well. That's the location of the data point in the area, and that's half of the complex prescription. That's the case of science, but it had to be with the other instances of it. But the second map that also matters is the isometric map. It shows how quickly the depth changes from the red to the solid and down to the blue. In a very small area, we go from about 200 to 500 meters down to about 1700 meters of water depth. So this is one of those white supremacies that is found all over the water. So why are we collecting? We are collecting because of the number of climate experts are preserving the feeding habitat of these two types of animals, so the spread whales, and then a city residence population called the bivalve whales. I think it was about when we figure out why those bivalves whales were in the spread whales like to come to the water. So we went out and we did a total sampling over the course of a couple of different years. We did a pretty good function where we did a little bit through very little genetics called agent trawlers off of the stern of the ship that we would fish them down at depth for about an hour, maybe 30 minutes, maybe 45 minutes, depending on conditions. And bring them back up onto shore. And so the bottom right image is a picture of the back up on the stern of the ship. And you can see those big blue bits. And so off to the right hand side there. And then we'll dig into some of those bits trying to find whether the fish or the squid, because squids don't get all tangled because they're normal arms and tentacles. And so it's a really wide labor of love. It takes a long time to get covered in fish slime and crustacean, predators and all sorts of things. But that's a great way to find cephalopods. That's a terrific way to find cephalopods. So this is one of the cephalopods we're interested in finding. This is a member of the family Gorgonia. This is Gorgonias fabricii. And the way that you can tell Gorgonias fabricii is at the end of one of its very long tentacles there. It's got an enormous hook right in the middle of the club. So this hook looks like a tax. The old rings coming out, and it's enormous. And so these animals are really voracious, thought to be voracious predators. Because there's a lot of tentacles that get tossed out. There are tons of fish, but that fish bring it back to its mouth or to the area. And so the idea is, when we went to the valley, we thought, well, we're going to throw these things over, we're going to come back with squids, and we're going to get flooded with looking at squids, because that's what we're using, there's a bottom as well. And then we get them because of the picture on the right shows this great big digestive gland, the big pink thing. It's a digestive gland that is full of fat. So it's full of fat, it's full of calories. And so that's a tasty morsel for an animal. It's got a lot of energy to be able to boost the animals. So we thought for sure we would break the gut full of the squids. And what we ended up with instead were a whole bunch of different kinds of squids. Now we got good units for sure, but we didn't get good units in the numbers that we had expected. And in fact, we had a great diversity of squids that. The literature chart tells us that squid life and squid mass, they take these kinds of squids down. Right? These are the one on the left hand side, the other big ugly monster with the giant teeth on it, sets it apart from this squid. It's also got a digestive gland that's full of animals, the best of wild, which is not supposed to be. And then we've got a variety of other things that they're using. And yeah, my octopus, that big black blob is actually a good polymorph. Is what it is, and it is called the paralithus infernalis, which translated into English means the paralithus squid from hell. And that was from its black color, it's actually a charming squid. So, you know, the octopus, I guess, it's got a lot of really interesting features in it. But some of the other cephalopods that you see there are in various stages of decomposition. Including westward breakage of this, which we found an awful lot of breakage of this. And so, one of the questions that becomes is the trends of the names of the areas that we couldn't find it, but we found out there's other things. Maybe they're not as reliant on breakages as we see other regions. Maybe this is a flash block of squids that's available out there in the valley that is a significant source for these squids. So, Thank you. squid. It's all of our sample squids in right now. But a lot of people pretending it's actually swimming for these things. There's pictures being taken about every 10 seconds. And so you can watch the cameras and you can go over the surface of the pond. If you look for a purple potato with two big eyes, you're going to watch it. But what can we do with this information? We can create great maps. We have all of the things that we have in this the big soccer ball perched on top of the ship. That is what is involved in creating this kind of telepresence. That's the real-time imagery. on the bottom right-hand side is the way that the amateur scientists are interacting. So the bottom, the center is a list of all the people who are involved, and this one is only a couple of us. On the right-hand side, there's, you know, who's in the chat room, and what's going on is that people are chatting and saying, that's a jellyfish, that's a crustacean, that's a this, that's a that, and they're talking the whole time. And it's a really an interesting way of, a very innovative way of doing this kind of research, and it's very real-time. And so you'll see chats go by, they say, I don't know what that was, what was that, but they can go get that book, and let's see if we can relook at that and figure it out. So it's real-time, highly identified, things are really well identified. So why does it happen? And we have the videographer right here who's taking a lot of these pictures, and on the top of the left-hand side, this is just a great shot of the two submersibles that are about to go overboard and are about to embark on one of these deep sea tugs. And so on the right-hand side, you have Deep Discover, the Deep Cube, and then on the left, there's Sirius. And Sirius is taking the picture of Deep Discover that you might see facing the bottom right-hand side. So they're the man kind of in tandem, and one is keeping an eye on the other, and the other is keeping an eye on the creatures of the geology. Okay, so now I have a couple of video shots of the sorts of things, fabulousness, that comes out of these explorations. There's an answer to the squid. That is a tremendous, that's a deep sea squid. Oh, look at that. It's kind of one is blending into the other, right? And there's not two squids there, it's just two shots of the same squid. And then if you see the one in the background, background squid, so it's long and it's skinny and it's deep dark red, and it's got these two arms that are bound towards the ocean bottom. And those are supporting the extra long tentacles. And those tentacles have tiny little segments of the bottom. The expectation is that they're being used kind of like flypaper, and they're moving through the water column, and the flypaper is catching all of the little creatures that are in the water column, and that's what they're going to eat. That's going to retrieve those tentacles that they eat the creatures off of them. So that's a great shot, behavioral shots, right? You don't actually have the specimen yet, but we've learned a lot about the behavior. Okay, let's see if I can make this work. All right, next shot. Again, from the Phoenix Canyon exploration, never before, about to miss the boat. What's about to happen that was never before seen? So this is an eel. I don't know the genus of the eel, but it's eating something, right? What is it eating? But if we're listening to the narration, this is eating the gargoyles, a bit like, is it an octopus? Is it a squid? Is it a cuttlefish? What is that? And is it great? This is the squid that I've heard. That it is. I'm pretty sure that it is. It's probably some kind of a glass squid. It's probably either a cephalopod or a charismatic pod. They're usually thought to be kind of big water squids, so I don't know if they're wrestled out of the big water or tied down to the ground and able to do all sorts of great things. But they would be foreseen at a predation event of a beetle on a cephalopod, which is great. So you can see why you can get lost, and these are the honest explorers, right? You can be out and just disappear. So here is a deep sea crab, probably in the Philippines, I guess. But this is really what you're looking for, right? So this is kind of a deep sea crab. So I mean, well, that was in that, but this is dark, and I drew that tiny little crab circle here. This is what it looks like up close and personal when you have the fabulous imagery, the fabulous technology that the Oceanus Explorer has. And that's it. And there's the octopus squid. Right? So that's the other one. It's a little long tree. And that's not a squid. That's a whole also these. And that's a whole okay. So, I mean, some of the images that come up out of the Oceanus Explorer are just so unbelievable. And how close you can get, you can count the number of vessels, you can count the number of warps, and it's remarkable. But again, the behavior is a lot of what comes out of this, which is really exciting. So here's Madeline Rosa, that's the same purple, not the coast that was just walking over the sediment. And there it is, but it's not exactly the same specimen, it's the same species. Right there it is under a ledge, and down the bottom of the ledge, there's about 1, 2, 3, 4 little tunics in the wall with four. They're like, you're going to see one in each one of those ultimately, the octopus will crawl away, and that's the end of life for that female. But it's just remarkable and just so cheerful, so much color out there, so much good stuff. And I have to put in my headshot to make this see how close are you to this octopus. Remember, we're working at 1,500 meters, which is 1,000 meters. But at the years, days in the eye, you can see the tubercles at the back of these octopods. They're just such great, another tip green makes a good call, portraits of the deep, where you envision these things in great giant bold designs. Just sort of, they just look like they're friends. Okay, so we're nearing the end here with this big purple potato. Right, this is the little purple potato with the big eyes sitting on the sediment when you're looking at it with the technology of the Oceanus Explorer. Here's one where he's floating in the water no longer so on the swim. And because the technology is so good, you can zoom in so close. These are sponges. And if you look inside the sponges, in both of the bottom images, you see eggs inside those sponges. And those eggs inside those sponges, we are pretty sure are ocean eggs. Because on one end activity, with one end image, we were able to zoom in close enough to see what was developing inside the egg. Right? It's just crazy.
It falls into eggs inside the sponges, inside a different species.
Inside the sponges, yes, that's right. So we've got octopods laying eggs on corals. We've got ocean laying eggs in the sponges. So it's tremendous. Okay, here's the final money shot. Great. So this was started with a nymphotuthis, and we're ending with a nymphotuthis. This is one of the serial octopods. They've got the fins, which you see over their eyes. They're generally called Dumbo octopods. This is technically not a Dumbo octopod, but it's close enough. And just the behavior that we've never seen before, like these corkscrewed arms, the way that they're being held. As it's using its fins to flap away, it's just really remarkable. And that was just, it's just one of those shots that if we had been out there simply with that, we wouldn't have got it. If we had been taking pictures, we wouldn't have got it. But the video guys could chase the squid and watch it do its thing, and it's just absolutely tremendous. So much fun. So I recommend tuning in to the another just finished the field season. The next one will start. I'm not sure when, but stay tuned and try to find it because. Because it's really just, it's a beast, right? But when it turns into So the red is, you know, one of those colors that when you get down deep enough, it is the same thing as being black, right? It's the last color to be Las Vegas. But there are also all sorts of animals down there, and it's the cephalopods that have the bivalves and whatever, but the fluids that are giving off the worst of them. And in that case, they are species specific. And the idea that it is a particular
This is really, really cool stuff, and I'm interested in this because I've been taking a biological geography course in existing, and we were talking about how organisms can use, I guess, bioluminescence, right, to either fend off prey or to attract prey. And when they were trying to film the giant squid for the first time, they used these little traps or little light producing animals to attract these organisms to come closer. Have you used those sort of thought about using those, and what do you think would be the effects, I guess?
That would be so fun. So I think what you're talking about is there was a group down at my building's Harbor Branch. And they developed a camera that had a flash of red light that would take place every couple of minutes, I think it was every few seconds. And it was positioned on the ocean bottom. And there must have been some sort of camera or picture taking device. I wasn't involved in it, so I don't really know. But the idea was, let's see what comes. And maybe we'll attract the giant squid, and that will be the first image of a giant squid, right? And I don't know that, and I think it has planted images of giant squids, and I think that that's tremendous, right? But it would be so much fun if it went down deep, right? I think that in terms of deploying it and recovering it, it's a challenge when you're working in canyons because they're so tight. And that's the appeal of them for animals in the woods, and like seeking refuge. So I think it would be a challenge to deploy them in the canyons in particular. But I think it would be great to dump them on it and let them kind of see what's really going on.
So, my work has been going into trying to find areas to protect in the deep sea. But just like, what's the greatest threat to deep sea cephalopods? Are they a threat? Are they a sea? Who might be trying to target them?
So to do sampling in the day and in the night because cephalopods are mobile, right? And they're moving on, and they're moving up and down in a diagonal path. And so we wanted to make sure that we had captured all of those variables. And then the bias of replication. So in the perfect world, you have a couple of replicates, and then you can do some actual statistics with these sorts of things. That turns out to be a lot harder than it seems. You know, it's really easy to do that kind of statistically significant sampling in your backyard. It's all more difficult to do in the middle of the ocean, of course. So,
so that's a kind of sample that will allow you to say, just to make it up, there's twice as many of a certain species. In that 500 meters in the daytime, in the deepest part of the canyon, in this other part of the time. But it does allow you to characterize the prevalence or the numbers and proportions across the entire canyon. Because it's a more purposive kind of sampling than like a random sampling. And so it's a cost to science not to have a real representative sampling plan.
It certainly is. So we end up borrowing it back even further. We're talking about your presence absence, right? So you really can't say that something is really missing because you haven't sampled the entire area. So yeah, it's definitely kind of exploration is so much in its infancy that trying to get the working examples and trying to have this very rigorous sampling approach, there's still an awful lot that can be learned without having that kind of robustness. And there are also ways in which you can measure the amount of water that has come through the nets, right? So you can have a flow meter attached to the bottom and you can make an estimate based on how wide the net is. So there is some way of bringing a little bit of quantitative analysis into it. But there are, and that's only so complicated by the fact that they're not all open and closing nets. And so when you're bringing a net down to depth, it's the mouth is open. So things that are honestly the boat is moving forward, you're sampling a few things, right? You might not be sampling the bulk of what you expect, but there's a little few little things getting going in there. So there's a lot of there's a lot of little work, there's an awful lot of error. That's right. Maybe you shouldn't try. And then there's also, the bakery you don't know. So you only get one of the samples at the end that you thought you were going to get three of. So you have to learn all of them when you're out at sea. You can't be too particular. But that's part of the fun of it.
Okay. Talking about the coast, and since it's also dark, what's useful to go on? Will they be on other activities that they change? Will they be different? And you get to come up with some or something like that.
To identify the egg, I think the egg is a group of genus. Yes, so that's based on comparison with other eggs on the cloud. So that's the first and last question first. Let's see, the second one was about coloring and writing about pottering in the skin. So the skin, so these animals here have very, so for example, the hippocampus has. Does it have the same number of chromatophores as some of the octopods that you see in shore that just kind of blend right into the background? But those octopods have chromatophores, and those chromatophores are under nervous system control. So that's why it can happen so quickly. And they sense their environment and blend in. These guys are not doing that. Really, they are. Some of them will have light organs, and they will have a kind of come hither approach, species identification. The other thing that some of these have and some don't is an ink sac. So one of the ways in which cephalopod is kind of famous for a squirt of ink and then getting out of the bag, out of harm's way. But if you don't get the ink, that's having a lot of ink doesn't really help disguise your escape. So yeah, there are modifications of the animals at these steps. But there is a little bit of a mystery as to why you need so many reflective surfaces that are lighting to know all different colors. The breaking Jesus squid that I pointed out has a lot of gold in it. And that's an interesting point, too. Why is there so much gold in these squids? And that's not a question I know how to answer.
How many species there are in the Atlantic?
That's a tough question. I should know this because I've just written it down in an abstract. But I think that we have collected on the order of 50 different genera, maybe. So there's a whole lot of the answer is a whole. But worldwide, there's somewhere around 800, somewhere between 800 and 1,000 worldwide species. So far, I'm going to look past it and say, I'm going to have to answer it because I should have done my homework there. But it's really a much smaller group than some of the animals, right? So the number of fishes, the number of crustaceans, there would still be a lot fewer cephalopods, which actually makes it a great group to try to wrap your arms around, to try to be able to take a picture of every single one of them, or do a DNA sample for every single one of them. So it opens up the small size of the taxon, really opens up a lot of possibilities.
Well, I just wanted to, before the next question, I was going to say, hey, Steve, Dr. Steve Ross is here. So he's the scientist whose research is featured in the film Bivalves, the Deepest, that we're about to have 15 minutes away. So Dr. Steve Ross, can you just tell us what your research is?
I'm a marine ecologist, and my specialty is in fishes, particularly the last few years, deep sea fishes. And I'm the chief scientist of an international multidisciplinary team that has worked on deep sea coral banks and submarine canyons for the last few years. And a lot of our research is coordinating with the Delaware Ocean Exploration and Research Office. And the film that you hopefully will see is related to that and to the talk that Liz is giving here. So, thanks.
So, we have time for just a couple more questions.
Significant difference between the number of species or the species themselves at different latitudes because everyone has dark blue pictures or similar. So, is latitude making a difference?
In the deep sea, collectively, it doesn't seem to, but certainly in terms of the shore species, and there's lots of species of shallow water animals, so they might not be moving towards the equator, and that holds true for cephalopods as well. And it's certainly not the case in deep sea, and it's certainly not the case in octopods. there's a giant ecosystem of seeds that we need on the ocean bottom. And you may have encountered them when you come to the quite unexpectedly on a trip to Cape Cod. I come to me with my kids, and there is a giant mop of cephalopods, right, attached to a rock or to a rock. And they really look like a little fashioned kind of mop that you might use to swap the ducks, right? And each one of those has hundreds of fertilized eggs in them.
So, thank you all for your fantastic questions.